Please join me in welcoming the great Attorney General of the State of New York, Letitia James.
I want to thank the mayor for those kind remarks, and I want to thank all of my colleagues in government and, of course, the members of law enforcement. I want to take a moment to acknowledge Rochester Police Officer Denny Wright and express my gratitude to him for his service and my relief that he was recently released from the Golisano Neurology Rehabilitation Center at Unity Hospital. I pray for his recovery, but it's also a reminder of all of the risks that officers take each and every day when they go out on the street for our safety. And so I pray every day that when they put on their badge and they go onto the streets, that they come home to their loved ones every night. So let us continue and let's pray for Denny's. Let's pray for him and hope that he returns to us. So we know that our law enforcement agencies are vital to keeping our community safe. We know that Rochester Police Department and Monroe County Sheriff's Office are vital to keeping our community safe. And so I am here today to partner with these agencies in ensuring that these communities remain safe, but also to keep the safety of our officers first and foremost. Today I'm excited to announce funds for two law enforcement agencies to support programs to outfit officers with body-worn cameras. And I do it, one, because outside is a little bit chilly and I'm in the holiday spirit. And so today we will give $104,000, $450 to Chief LaRon Singletary and the Rochester Police Department. I want to say come on down, but he's to my right. And I want to give $59,694 to the Monroe County Sheriff's Office. Yay! The Rochester Police Department used these funds to purchase 70 body-worn camera systems and 15 body-worn camera docking stations. And the reason why I state that in the past is because this is a reimbursement program. And so the body-worn cameras are up and operating, and we are here to reimburse them for their expense related thereto. The Monroe County Sheriff's Office will be able to purchase approximately 30 body-worn camera systems and 6 body-worn camera docking stations. And so I am glad to announce those two gifts. These funds are part of my office's Capture an Account of a Material Situation, or CAMS, program. And through this program, we will ultimately distribute a total of more than $1 million to cover the purchase of 891 body-worn cameras and 321 body-worn camera systems for 13 law enforcement agencies throughout the state of New York. And just this morning, I presented checks for more than $238,000 to the Buffalo, Niagara Falls, and Amherst police departments for 442 body-worn cameras. And last week, we presented the Ulster County Sheriff's Office with more than $69,000 for 93 body-worn cameras. This important program is funded with money recovered from the organized crime takedowns carried out by the Attorney General's office, and I am pleased that we can use these funds to reinvest in our communities and for programs that truly benefit everyone. The importance of body-worn cameras cannot be overstated. They are critical tools for providing transparency, accountability, and protecting public safety. And when I say public safety, I mean the safety of both civilians and the officers who dedicate their lives to protecting us each and every day. And while these are common sense tools, the reality is that many local law enforcement agencies do not have the resources to purchase them. And with cameras alone costing up to almost $1,000 each, agencies are finding it difficult to outfit their entire force. And that is why my office stepped in and why we've created this program. And I know just how important body-worn cameras are. In fact, I was one of the leading proponents of outfitting the New York City Police Department with them when I was the public advocate of the City of New York. They help to ensure fairness, justice, and safety and objectivity, and they benefit both law enforcement and the general public, and they will always be my top priority. So I thank the members of law enforcement, and I thank all of you, and the next speaker that we will hear from is the great Congressmember Joe Morelli.
Good afternoon. It's a pleasure to join all of you today. First, let me thank all my friends and partners in government who have joined us today. The great mayor of the city of Rochester, who I have the privilege of working on so many different initiatives on and is doing just an amazing job each day moving the city forward. The Mayor, Lovely Warren, thank you, Your Honor, for all of your great work. To Sheriff Baxter and Chief Singletary, who I'm convinced there are multiples of each one of them, because they are two people who are, and I say this, even when they're not in the room, I say this, that both are so dedicated and committed to being members and parts of this community, and whether it's philanthropic organizations, non-governmental organizations, I mean, they're at events all the time, and so I'm so pleased with their incredible service to this community. To the county clerk, who I know is busy doing some things these days and running around, so thank you for taking time out of your schedule. And my assembly member, Jamie Romeo, I still struggle saying that, but who's doing such a great job in the state assembly and is now finishing her first year. And of course, the Attorney General, who I've had the privilege of knowing for many, many years and watched her rise from her tenure serving in the state assembly when we first met many years ago, and to watch every level of government that she's been at. She has distinguished herself with her leadership qualities, her compassion, her intellect, and this is another chapter in the incredible work that she's doing, and I'm just so grateful to have her as a partner. And I think as I echo the comments of the Attorney General, to thank all of our law enforcement officials who are not only here today, but are at this moment out on the streets protecting people in this community. It's a difficult job, it's a difficult world that we all live in, and to try to ensure justice for everyone is a difficult task. So I appreciate everything that they do, and it's really important, and I want to congratulate the Attorney General for her foresight in putting this program together, because technology is very important. It's one of the great tools that we use to try to ensure justice, to make sure that our men and women who are out on the streets every day have the kind of resources and technology available to try to ensure that justice. So these body-worn cameras are a critical tool, not only because they increase transparency and accountability, but they strengthen that trust, the vital trust needed between police and the citizens that they protect. So camera footage provides critical independent accounts of police encounters, helping to strengthen firsthand evidence and investigations and provide peace of mind for members of the public. And these are exactly the kind of investments we need to be making. It helps ensure a successful and unified community. And we've seen the success of body cameras that have been implemented throughout Rochester, and the funding announced today will only build upon that success. And so I'm very, very grateful. I know that all of us in this community are, for her advocacy and for her being here for today. And obviously the funds are important, but what's even more important is the partnership and her continued interest in the people in this community and the people of the state. And for that, I'm very, very grateful. So thanks so much for the opportunity to be here, and Godspeed. Thank you.
Now I'd like to invite Monroe County Sheriff Todd Baxter to deliver some remarks. Sheriff?
Well, thank you, Attorney General, and we would just like to extend a hearty thank you for this funding. As you mentioned in your open remarks, these cameras are very expensive. They're a tool that the community expects us to have, but the budgets sometimes don't support that expectation by the community, so this funding is absolutely essential. With this funding, the Monroe County Sheriff will move towards, the Sheriff's Office will move towards full deployment of body-worn cameras on the road patrol, which we're very excited about, not only for the accountability that people are looking for and the transparency, but there's other aspects of this. You look at these deputies and these officers up here, their job is incredibly, incredibly tough, and accountability is one part of it, but also, you know, where does our training needs, and where do we identify training things that we got to work on? We go back and review these videos, and we look at training gaps that we got to fix and to keep them safe on the road. We look at protecting them from frivolous complaints, you know, complaints against police officers also. So there's many, many tools that a body-worn camera fulfills for us. There are many options that this tool fulfills for us. We're very excited about this funding and to keep our officers and our deputies safe. We're very excited about going full deployment finally. Last year, we talked so much about, Denny Wright, and we talk about the officers getting injured, but, we get to see firsthand what these guys go through as leaders, and when you see those videos and you see firsthand what these guys and gals go through, it just keeps you on your toes of moving forward and keeping these people as safe as possible. So this is just a great tool and many, many options that we use it for. So I just wanted to share some of those options with you. Again, Attorney General, cannot appreciate enough of this this funding, and thank you for joining us in Rochester.
Thank you. And now I'd like to invite Rochester Police Chief LaRon Singletary to deliver some remarks. And right after his remarks, we will see Officer Jim LaRuez and Kara Engelin. They'll provide a demonstration of the body cameras. Chief.
Thank you again, Attorney General. I just want to thank you again for the generous funds that you have, totaling over $100,000, which is going to allow the Rochester Police Department to move forward to expand our body worn camera program to those officers who consistently interface with citizens of our community. In addition, the funds will allow our department to purchase upgraded docking stations to download and transfer videos, allowing for a quicker connection time between the cameras and the docking stations. The body worn camera program, as was stated earlier, is an opportunity to protect our officers from erroneous allegations and allows law enforcement to be held accountable while providing quality service to our citizens. I think I mentioned earlier, several weeks ago, on October 4th, when I saw the body-worn camera attack of Officer Denny Wright, I explained it as horrible. Like the sheriff said, we could look at that video and look at training opportunities and to provide accounts as to what occurred when our officers go out there and put their lives on the line each and every day. So this funding is instrumental in the carrying out the services that we provide to the citizens of Rochester. And I couldn't thank you enough. I want to thank all our elected officials. Attorney General, again, thank you so much. This time I'll have Lieutenant Kowski come forward with some remarks, as well as Sergeant Kara Englund and Officer Jimmy LaRue with the instructions.
I want to thank you as well for the funds. Pretty surprising that I'm up here, but we're able to expand our program from 505 cameras to 575 cameras. I think that with the support of Mayor Lovely Warren and the chief, it was a long time to get this project off the ground. I'm very proud of it. I think that it took a while for the officers to get used to, but I see every day the help that it gives them in performing their job. You know, as the chief said, accountability and transparency is one part of it. You know, we do occasionally get complaints that aren't necessarily the way everything happened. So we do have a true account of what happened when the officers go to different 911 calls. So what the money allows us to do is, like the chief said, is update some of our existing docks for the connectivity and to make sure that the videos are uploaded to our secured servers, and it also allows us to expand our program to additional patrol officers on the street. That's all I have. Do you want to give a demonstration? Go ahead, Jim.
Beginning of the day, I take this off to the dock, go to roll call, then I just power it up. About 10 seconds to power up. And I go out and work my day. I'll be in my police car. I'll go to a job. As soon as I pull up on that job, when it's safe to do so inside my car, I just hit the button down here and start recording. So then I got my police car, go handle whatever the issue is or what we're helping with that day. Come back to the police car. Once I'm in the police car and I'm safe, I just have to hit the button again.
You have to hold it.
Hold down. And then it's done recording. Also has the option, when buttoned up, just take pictures. So if I'm on a job scene and I need to take pictures to capture evidence or whatever, just hit the button once, and it clicks, and takes the picture for me, and it saves it. So at the end of my shift, I go back to the office, I take it back into the docking station, put it in there, and it saves all the video and all the pictures that I have that day.
Thank you so much.
And our last speaker is my very good friend, Assemblywoman Jamie Romeo.
Again, I just want to thank the Attorney General for coming back to Rochester. We've seen her a lot, and we always look forward to seeing you here and for this important investment for our law enforcement opportunities. And I will say, particularly with all of the partners in government we have here, as we continue to move Rochester to make New York State a more just community, that we need to make sure we're advocating for our law enforcement, for all of the ways that we need to be able to support our law enforcement officers to have the tools they need in the field. And this is an incredible day because this is an important step towards that. But it's not the last step. There will be lots more conversations we need to continue to have to make sure that all the parts of our criminal justice system have what they need in the field in order to make sure that everybody, we can move towards a more just society in New York State. So thank you again for being here.
I appreciate it. Thank you so much. Congratulations. A couple of points. I think it's critically important that individuals understand that protocol is being established so that body-worn cameras are not activated during certain incidents. They include but are not limited to domestic violence and sexual assault. And so it's really critically important that we understand the protocols that are in place. And two, I recognize that there are some soft expenses related to body-worn cameras. Today our check is primarily for hard costs. For the camera, for the docking stations. But there are costs related, obviously, to training, there's costs related to storage, and there's costs related to FOIL, the Freedom of Information Request. And so hopefully going forward, as we continue to recover funds as part of our criminal proceeds, we can come back and present another check to relieve the mayor and the executive of those costs as well. So we're going to do some on topic, and then after we do some, take some pictures, then we will do some off topic, and I have another announcement that I would like to make in regards to the IJC. On topic only.
How soon will the money be available for the departments so that they can purchase the money?
So again, this is a reimbursement program, and so the cameras they have already, we are here just to reimburse them for the expenses that they have already laid out.
How does the department apply for these? I mean, we have numerous towns and even some village departments that probably have fewer resources than the county and the city. How do they get in line to get some of this funding?
So we opened it up. A number of counties reached out to us, and as I indicated at the outset of my remarks, we provided some resources already. At this point in time, the application process is closed. At some point in the future, we look forward to reopening that process. We also look forward to, again, reaching out to the state legislature in this budgetary process and asking them to assist us in providing resources as well.
So a community has to apply for this
plan? Correct. Yes, sir.
Questions for Chief Moran, Military, if that's okay. Sheriff Todd Baxter mentioned that this gets dumped close to every shift being filled with body cameras. Is that the same of RPD?
I'm sorry, what was the last part of your question?
As far as body cameras go, with this funding, how close are you to full deployment during a given shift?
Well, right now, all of our patrol officers are fully deployed with body-worn cameras. So this allows us to deploy to neighborhood service center officers, our community affairs bureau officers, and the like. So all the patrol officers are currently have body-worn camera program.
Chief Sigler, you mentioned erroneous allegations. Can you give us some example? What kind of erroneous allegations are you talking about?
Well, in particular, sometimes during the day in the course of our duties, you know, supervisors may receive complaints on officers with regard to whether it's courtesy issues and things of that nature. And supervisors have the ability now to go look at the body-worn camera from that incident and determine whether the complaint is erroneous or, in fact, valid, and make a determination from there.
And also, in the demonstration, it was a bit unclear to me when the camera is required to be turned on. When can it be turned on? When can it be turned off?
The body-worn camera program right now, the rules and regulations are when it's safe and practical for an officer to turn the camera on upon responding to a call for service. So as the officer's pulling up, the officer can operate the body-worn camera program, or any time there is a law enforcement action that's going to be taken, the officer can initiate the camera.
And if they turn it off, they don't turn it on, what happens?
Well, there's a certain level of discipline process that can be going through.
Chief, there was some early criticism of the cameras being big, being clunky, the technology, having to upload to servers instead of the cloud. Have some of these adjustments been made the longer you've had them, and do you feel it's a more smooth process?
I believe it is a smooth process now. We have made adjustments, and I can let Lieutenant Perkowski, our body-worn camera program coordinator, speak to that. But I think we have made those adjustments, and certainly when the camera initially came out, yes, it was big, it was clunky, and I think the officers over a three-year period now has become familiar with the camera.
In terms of full deployments, how far away are you?
So the funding in the RFP was just put out, and we realized the end product of that. So we're opening up the proposals literally today. So hopefully we'll have a vendor signing a contract soon. We'd like to start deploying towards the end of this year, if not the beginning of next year, because of the funding cycle also in this grant. So We're expecting the next few months that we'll start deploying these new cameras.
But in terms of full deployment for the entire department?
Yeah, that's the, we'll probably have to do an incremental step going forward with our goal as we start deploying by the end of this year.
And you also mentioned skill gaps found on the footage. What were you addressing?
Yeah, so I'd like to go back to your earlier question, and I'll answer that one. You know, when I was the chief of the Greece Police Department, we had a complaint against a police officer. The complaint came in, the officer body handled someone, threw him into the back seat of the police car so hard that he went through and hit his head on the far side of the other side of the back of the police car door. Luckily, we found video that showed just the opposite, that never occurred. Not only did we exonerate the police officer, who was a good police officer just doing his job in a very difficult task, but we also lodged charges against the suspect for making a false complaint. That is not our goal. We just want the complete information of what occurs in these incidents so we can look at them completely and have all the facts patterns. So again, the video doesn't give us everything. You know, it gives us a snapshot of what's occurring, but it gives us more information than we ever had before when we got to make decisions on what our deputies and our officers are doing, that now we're capturing as much information as possible. It's exciting. And then as far as training gaps, you know, say there's an officer involved shooting and we're looking at the body-worn camera. Did the officer use proper tactics? Could the officer have taken cover, concealment better? Did the suspect move and increase an angle on the police officer, which exposed the police officer? Not only are we looking at it from an internal affairs standpoint, we're also looking at this video from a training standpoint and just making sure we're doing the proper training to keep these guys and gals safe out on the road. There's no better way to look at it. You know, we think about football games, we all go back on Monday and look at video cameras of, was that a touchdown? And we look at it for seven different directions in super slow-mo, you know, and then we critique on Monday what the football team did, you know. So we're getting the same thing here, but I just want to emphasize that we're only getting one small snapshot. We're not getting, you know, seven different angles with a slow-mo, but it gives us a whole nother way to look at what the police officers are doing, what the deputies are doing, and also what we're doing in our training, because our training time is so valuable. We've got to make as much out of it as we can. So looking at what's really occurring on the road and producing our training to keep these guys and gals safe is a very important part of this program.
Sheriff, how critical would you say this is in today's day and age of social media, where any civilian on the street can also pull out their phone, take a video of it, maybe it's 15 seconds, 10 seconds, or
right,
5, 6, 10 minute interaction?
Yeah, well, you're getting a before and after. You're getting an unedited version. You know, we've seen, you know, complaints come out on social media, and you can obviously see it's an edited video, which doesn't help with our transparency. We're trying to build trust. We spend so many time, money, man hours in building trust with the community, right? And it takes one video with a complaint against it, it's going to break all these years of trust building that we're, you know, in a matter of a second. So if we can get our information out there as quick as possible, unedited, and let the community make a decision on whether they think we're right or wrong, but the fact is they got all the information as possible, I think is absolutely essential to the transparency and the trust building.
Ms. James, the money from this particular seizure account, is it earmarked specifically for body cams?
No, for a number of crime-related or crime-preventive activities. And right now, we're dedicating it towards body cameras all throughout the state of New York. In the city of New York, as you know, body-worn cameras have exonerated a number of police officers as a result of complaints that have been filed by civilians. And so I thought it was useful, and that's why the Attorney General is on the road giving out checks.
The money gone in that account?
We have a number of other announcements. How about that? Any other questions?
So,
so our goal is to eventually replace the ones we currently have on the road. It's older technology, but we don't have enough money, you know, to do that. So again, going through the incremental steps, we'll get the new cameras on the road, and then we'll slowly phase out as more funding becomes available through our budget or through other grants to replace the older cameras, right? So that's the first part. The second part is when we talk about full deployment in the sheriff's office, we will not have individual assigned cameras. We won't have enough for that. But we should have enough initially for every patrol officer going out on normal patrol duties in the sheriff's office to be issued a camera as they go out after roll call.
For the Rochester Police Department, it's adding to the cameras that we currently have. It's not replacing. It's adding to the current structure we have.
So then will every
currently, every officer in patrol has a body-worn camera. We're looking to expand the program to like our community police officers, our crime prevention officers who work in the neighborhood service center. A lot of the officers, we have interfacing obligations to deal with the community. So we're just expanding the program, and that's what this funding is allowing us to do.
So we're going to take some pictures, and then I have an announcement with regards to the International Joint Commission. I'll come back to the podium, and then I'll take some off-topic questions. And here are the checks.
That's all I have to see.
Okay, Monroe, here you go.
Thank you, ma'am.
You're welcome.
Six pictures. Let's come up here.
Stand up in front.
Come on, join us. Anybody want to take individual pictures for the newsletter?